This video was made possible by Skillshare. Start learning new skills with a free trial by being one of the first 1,000 to join at the link in the description. Hello and welcome to another episode of Half as Storytime. I'm Sam, your storyteller, and today's story comes from one of my very favorite books, the Rand Corporation's classic, A Million Random Digits with 100,000 Normal Deviates. Let's get started. 10097325337, and oh, here's my favorite part, 6. I know, pretty good story, right? What makes this book so great is that these days, stories are so predictable. We know the couple will always reunite, the underdog will always win, and the talented chef will always be secretly controlled by a rat that's under his hat. With this book, though, it's impossible to accurately guess what will happen next, because that's the whole point. Its pages are filled with 1 million numbers that are more random than a tween on Tumblr in 2009. If you're wondering why anyone would print, let alone buy, a book of a million random numbers, I'd first remind you that they sold millions of copies of Twilight retold from the vampire's perspective. People will read literally anything, and also, they've gotten at least one sale from someone making an educational YouTube video, but mostly, there are a number of reasons that someone might need random numbers. The most significant would be for random sampling because, of course, in order to take a random sample, after all, you need random numbers. Say an engineer, for example, was tasked with inspecting welds on an old bridge. Checking just the first few would make it more likely to miss a problem, and checking all of them would take far too long to be done regularly, so they might use this book to get random numbers to pick a truly random sampling of welds to inspect, ensuring that the only thing that could harm the bridge would be decades of political gridlock on infrastructure funding. In addition to this, pollsters, experimental researchers, and plenty of other people need random numbers to perform their job, or you might need them for other things such as cryptography, electronic gambling machines, Monte Carlo simulations, random jury selections, and deciding which of your friends you're going to frame for tax evasion as a TikTok prank. But of course, you probably have a big question. Why do people need to pay $68, or $54.40 for a limited time, for a book of random numbers? I mean, couldn't a person just sit down and come up with random numbers by themselves? After all, that's what the president did when he filed his tax returns. And yes, George Soros did pay me to tell that joke. It turns out, however, that researchers have conducted studies on this very question of whether humans can be truly random and came to the same conclusion as every other study on human cognition. No, of course we can't, because people are idiots, especially you, yes you, in particular. In this case, it turned out that when people are asked to list off digits randomly, we all end up saying 1 way too often and almost completely forget about 5. So basically, humans have innate biases that lead us to supposedly randomly pick certain numbers more than others. That means that if it was down to human randomness, the fifth weld on the bridge might never get inspected. To solve this problem, enter the Rand Corporation, a charmingly shadowy think tank full of big smart brains that mainly consults for the US Armed Forces, because after all, there's nothing more random than the US's foreign policy decisions. Back in 1947, the Douglas Aircraft Company provided them with a machine that would register random fluctuations in voltage in a vacuum tube machine into simple strings of ones and zeros. Because it was the 1950s and computers still had the processing power of an inbred potato, they had to do a bunch of complicated stuff to convert these strings into numbers. A circuit board converted the ones and zeros into digits from 0 to 9, which another machine turned into punch cards, fed into an IBM data processing machine, read a bedtime story, and then finally put into this book. Despite its massive popularity in the late 20th century, these days, the book is somewhat obscure. Just like switchboard computers, video rental stores, and all my free time, it has been overtaken by computers. Now, computers' semi-random number generation works fine for pollsters, engineers, and statisticians, but for certain applications, like gambling machines, using computers as random number generators is still pretty fraught because computers are deterministic. In other words, computers are only capable of doing exactly as their programming tells them, meaning they can never actually create true randomness. Of course, you can write an algorithm to spit out a bunch of seemingly random numbers, but they won't really be random, not like legit, authentic, non-GMO random. That's because they'll be determined by that algorithm, and if someone can recreate the algorithm, they can predict your random numbers faster than today's Reddit memes can predict tomorrow's Instagram memes. In fact, there's a Russian man, named some Russian name, who has reverse engineered this pseudo-random number generator of a number of slot machines and used that information to steal millions from casinos. True randomness, then, has to be based on some sort of actual, real-world physical object or phenomenon that exhibits randomness, like Geiger counters, lightning storms, lava lamps, or a teenager's emotions. Recently, the million-digit book has come under scrutiny after a RAND engineer, Gary Briggs, was in COVID quarantine and had already finished Tiger King, and so did what any rational person would do and spent his free time reverse engineering the process that converted the original strings of ones and zeros into the digits 0 through 9 and found that a few translation errors were made, likely when someone dropped and then switched a few of the punch cards used by the old-timey IBM machines. The good news is, the numbers are still definitely random, just a few are in the wrong order of random. The bad news is, though, that Gary Briggs is still definitely a huge nerd. The thing about nerds, though, is that these days, being a nerd is cool. Just ask Bill Gates or Jimmy Neutron or that total dork over at Wendover Productions. So if you're thinking that you want to get a little nerdier and learn a new skill, you should check out Skillshare, the online learning community where millions of creatives can learn more about their passions and interests. There are plenty of great ones that teach you how to become a great YouTuber, for example, like Polly Manner's class on how to make animated YouTube videos or Susan Orlean's on creative nonfiction. Often the toughest bit of growing a YouTube channel is all the learning you have to do at the start, but these courses and others give you a great head start, and if you want to learn something different, they also have fantastic classes on illustration or photography or design or writing or filmmaking or so much more. You can get a free trial for Skillshare when you're one of the first 1,000 to sign up at the link in the description.